You all may have heard about the nuclear bomber, but what we know is that they have a tail. You might not have heard about a nuclear bomber without a tail. A nuclear bomber without a tail. Can it be true? Absolutely. In fact, it is. Let us find out who is it. Hello, friends. Welcome back to Future Warplanes. Today, we are back here again with an interesting video. You might not have heard of nuclear bombers without a tail. Here, we are not only going to tell its name, but also we will open here its history and current. So stick with the video and watch it till the end to know everything about it. Before that, let us know in the comment box what you all know about a nuclear bomber. Also, subscribe to our channel to watch more videos like this. Let us start with the video. V-bombers were Royal Air Force aircraft in the 1950s and 60s that composed the UK's Strategic Nuclear Strike Force, the V-Force or Bomber Command Main Force. Vickers Valiant first flew in 1951 and entered service in 1955. Avro Vulcan first flew in 1952 and entered service in 1956, and Handley Page Victor first flew in 1952 and joined service in 1957. 50 Valiants, 70 Vulcans, and 39 Victors served in June 1964. When Soviet surface-to-air missiles like the S-75 Dvina could destroy high-flying aircraft, the V-bomber force switched to low-level attacks. Blue Steel's profile was altered to low-level penetration and release. Its range shrank. The Skybolt air-launched ballistic missile was then proposed. The V-Force's survival was in doubt when the U.S. scrapped Skybolt. The Royal Navy took up nuclear deterrence in 1968, employing UGM-27 Polaris submarine-launched ballistic missiles. SEPECAT, Jaguar, and Panavia Tornado took over tactical duties. V-bombers could also drop conventional armaments thanks to a powerful analog computer system called the Navigation and Bombing System. The Valiants were utilized during the Suez Crisis as conventional bombers. During the Indonesia-Malaysia dispute, Victors and Vulcans were deployed as a deterrence but not employed. The Vulcan is well remembered for its conventional black buck bombing sorties during the 1982 Falklands War. All three designs have tanker variants for such missions. Reconnaissance variants were manufactured, and other changes were also made throughout their existence. Valiants were retired in 1964 due to wing metal fatigue. A low-level variation never made it through the prototype stage. Nuclear and conventional V-bomber use terminated in 1982. This was a brief introduction. We hope you are enjoying the video. If yes, let us know in the comment box right now. Also, subscribe to our channel if you haven't yet. RAF Bomber Command used big four-piston aircraft for mass attacks during World War II and immediately thereafter. The RAF used an improved variant of the wartime Avro Lancaster, the Avro Lincoln. After World War II, 450 Lincolns were constructed. Although a formidable bomber in 1945, it lacked the range to reach Soviet objectives and was susceptible to emerging jet fighters. The 1943 Quebec Agreement united Britain's two Balloys nuclear weapons effort with the Manhattan Project. The British government expected the U.S. to continue sharing nuclear technology, which it considered a collaborative discovery after the war, but the 1946 Atomic Energy Act terminated technical cooperation. The British government feared fighting an enemy alone if the U.S. reverted to isolationism, as it did after World War I. It feared Britain's great power position and global influence. It resumed high-explosive research, its nuclear weapons program. In 1952, Operation Hurricane tested the first British atomic weapon. In November 1946, the Air Ministry published an operating requirement for an advanced jet bomber capable of transporting a 10,000-pound bomb 2,000 nautical miles from a base, anywhere in the globe at 500 knots and between 35 and 50,000 feet. An older atomic bomb operating requirement, OR-1001, stipulated a 10,000-pound maximum weight. Speed and altitude were required to penetrate hostile air defenses. The plane couldn't exceed 200,000 pounds. Supply originally declined OR-230. This aircraft needs a 2,000-yard runway, according to calculations. Bomber Command's runways were designed for Lancaster, therefore enlarging them would be costly and require land purchase and destruction. The Avro 707 was built to test the Vulcan's tailless, thick delta wing shape. Armstrong Whitworth, Avro, English Electric, and Handley Page submitted design bids on 30 April 1947. On 28 July 1947, a tender design conference ordered Avro's design and a tiny flying model to test its delta wing concept. The meeting also voted to study crescent wings as a backup plan for the delta wing design. Design options included Handley Page and Armstrong Whitworth. In November 1947, the Ministry of Supply awarded Avro an ITP order. The Handley Page design was also issued an ITP on 23 December 1947. The 17 December 1946 conference that produced OR-230 also resolved to invite proposals for a more conservative design that could be put into service more rapidly and function as insurance against the failure of both advanced ideas. From this operational requirement, OR-239, the Air Ministry issued B-1446 on 11 August 1947. This has lower cruising altitude and speed restrictions than B-3546. Short's design was approved in November 1947. The result was the Short Sparin, a conservative jet with straight wings. So here we are going into the details of the craft. Subscribe to the channel if you haven't yet, and comment down below if you have anything in your mind. The Vickers Armstrong 660 featured sweeping wings. This was rejected because it didn't match the B-3546 standard, but Sparin's predicted performance made the Air Ministry authorities reconsider. Vickers plane Armstrongs was called Valiant. Bombers were formerly called after British or Commonwealth cities, but in 1952, the Air Ministry adopted alliterative names for the Avro Vulcan and Handley Page Victor. The three were dubbed V-bombers. While more costly, the RAF insisted on having options. Air Chief Marshal Sir John Slessor feared the Air Force would have picked the incorrect bomber amongst the Avro Manchester, Short Stirling, and Handley Page Halifax in the late 1930s. As a stopgap, the British stated on 27 January 1950 that they would receive free Boeing B-29 Super Fortress bombers from the U.S. This enabled the Air Ministry to abandon the development of the Sparin. The RAF called the B-29 Washington B-1. First Washington delivered to RAF 22 March 1950, 87th in June 1952. It had the range to reach the Soviet Union from British bases, but it wasn't nuclear capable. The RAF intended to attack Soviet bomber sites. Most Washingtons were returned to the U.S. between July 1953 and July 1954, owing to a scarcity of spare parts. Four continued in service until 1958. Their duty was taken by the new jet-propelled English Electric Canberra bomber. The National Cold War Exhibition opened at RAF Cosford in Shropshire on 8 February 2007 to chronicle the Cold War's narrative. First time all three versions of V-bombers were shown together. Public contributions financed Vulcan XH-558 until October 2015. Air shows and events featured it. It will be used to illustrate how sophisticated its design was at the time. That's all for this video. We hope you like our video. If yes, let us know in the comment box and drop a like. Also, subscribe to our channel and hit the bell icon to get the notification of our latest videos. Thanks for watching.